Very efficient.
Yes.
Okay.
Excellent.
So we get thumbs up.
Yeah, can
you Kaylin, are you seeing our cover screen now? Yeah, okay.
Perfect.
Great. And then you want to just
monitor
for a moment?
Yeah, I will.
As we, okay.
Yes.
All right.
You're particularly good at keeping track of all the different things.
Well, we're going to go ahead and get started. I think we all know each other, but I'm Damon Brown. I'm the middle school director. This is Trevor Lindsay, has been and will continue to be middle years program coordinator. And then Christian Bondi, who's been sharing the role of middle years program coordinator and will be next year kind of expanding our student support services and things like that. So with still a huge focus on middle school, and she's definitely very much part of our middle school leadership team. And so this look ahead presentation is designed to help you know not everything about the middle school, but many of the things that you're going to see that are exciting, things that are new, things that we're looking forward to sharing with you.
Cool. We probably won't go over the full agenda either, but you can see just some of the topics we're going to talk about. I think this is more for those folks who are going to view this later that they can, you know, we'll be sharing this out with the community. So we'll just jump right into it. If you've been to one of Christian's and my presentations throughout the year, we always like to start by reminding everyone that we kind of look at everything we do through the lens of our school mission, and that we view our mission as being very student-centered. So we look at how to structure everything that we kind of do in the middle school around us doing the very best we can to make the best experience for our students. And we try to set that in our meetings. We try to set that when we talk with the community, that that is our priority. And that's the lens that we're looking through every decision we make. Letting more people in.
Yeah.
Cool.
And then, yeah, similarly, we guide our curriculum, our instruction, our decisions through our pillars, and we try to fit our pillars throughout the year, whether it's through outdoor ed, our Wednesday
management here for a moment. We get it?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So one of the things as we look ahead, Damon and I have been IB educators for 18 and 17 years respectively. So we've been working in this a lot. And I think if you talk to an IB educator, they'll let you know that because of what we ask teachers to do, the connections we ask them to make and the understanding of their curriculum, but then how that makes the best impact for students, it takes a year or two or three to really nail it. And so teacher retention is really important to us. And that's been a heavy goal of ours this year. We brought a great crew in and we wanted to make the best experience we could for them. And then keep that ball rolling forward. We are sad to announce that Mary Penny, our science and math teacher, is retiring from education and on to her, next phase of her life. But we're thrilled to announce that Bailey Pullman, who is a really successful, really beloved high school teacher, is going to be stepping into that role. And otherwise, bringing the entire gang back. So we have our full faculty and our full leadership team in the middle school back for next year to take what we are really proud of that we did this year and make it that much better next year. So we will welcome Bailey to the team. She's moving down from the high school and is thrilled by the culture and the sort of opportunities that the middle school presents. And it's kind of just up and up from here. So so that is one thing that we were very happy to share. We're coming back and stronger and better than ever. So, yep. You want to go to the next one? And the three of us are coming back. I don't know if that's good news for all of you or not, but here we are. So you're stuck with us. No, I'm just kidding. We are slightly reprising our roles just a little bit, but we will remain the kind of three-pronged leadership team in the middle school. And just credit, we've tried to do this in other ones, but a lot of credit to Damon. He is an incredible leader who really facilitates a team-oriented approach. All of our perspectives are really valued, and I think that trickles down to teachers feeling the same way.
Absolutely.
And that's kind of a vibe that runs through our entire middle school, and that's a lot of credit to Damon. So, yeah. So we're happy to be coming back and doing it again.
Yeah.
All right, schedule enhancements. So this year we made a few shifts in the schedule where we got math to happen, math and language to happen more frequently, those classes that require, you know, practice to for those skill improvements. And one of the big changes that we've noticed is while we like having math classes more frequently, they were too short, so we made them longer. And that's how we try to problem solve, right? We identify a problem and we try to fix it. So we'll continue to have support blocks for each grade level twice a week with opportunities for tune-up and enrichment. We're offering 7 different levels of math to middle school students that they can test into through our process. And some of you will notice that we've added a new higher level of math. That's intentional. We have a group of students who's definitely ready for that experience, and so we're excited to be able to offer it. We're gonna have 5-minute passing periods. This year we've had 3-minute passing periods, and they're not long enough. So we're gonna be fixing that.
When you say passing periods, you mean to get the one class
right.
Yes.
And with the
yes, nature, getting to the trailers a little bit more.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Island Park, as we like to
call it. Yes. Now it has a beautiful sign.
Right. Is a bit of a hike, and so we're making that adjustment to make sure kids feel supported. Mm-hmm. Again, student centered, that they feel like they have the time to not feel rushed on their way to and from.
Did we have 5 minutes at parent-teacher conferences too?
TBD, but that's a great maybe like 6.5. We'll meet in the middle.
I gotta ask, just because, you know, is it a special math thing that we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, skip 7 and have 8?
That's actually a great question. The reason that we're doing that is because typically we think of more or less, mostly 1 and 2 is taken by 6th graders, mostly 3 and 4 is taken by 7th graders, mostly 5 and 6 is taken by 8th graders, not always, but mostly. And then all we're doing is we have a group of students who's ready for a more advanced math course. And the way our curriculum is numbered, we're not offering the year 7 course, we're offering the year 8 course. It's just the way our numbering system works.
Right.
Yeah.
And previously, those students were going to high school math courses, and it was causing a lot of schedule conflicts. So now it's embedded in the middle school.
Right.
Yeah.
To expand our math program.
Yeah. The other thing that we're doing is we're working really hard to make sure that even though we're offering the math and language more frequently, we're also trying to make sure that we have blocks adjusted so that kids have mixed groups throughout the day, so they get to be with more different kids throughout their school day. That helps with social stuff, and it also just helps every class feel like maybe a new interesting experience with different voices in there. So as much as is humanly possible, we're trying to get mixing from one period
within one grade level or with across
within grade level. Within one grade level, with the exception of math and electives, which are across grade level, right? Mm-hmm. The other thing that a byproduct of this is we're seeing more core courses, especially math, happening earlier in the day for the most part, which is generally good for students' learning.
Mm-hmm. So those are our schedule.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just an overview of this, if you've been around before, this is just a little, some of the benefits of our schedule. When we made the move last year to kind of create a middle school centric schedule, we were again really doing it student centered. We were trying to meet the needs of middle school students in their development as learners. We have 9 different subject groups. We are offering 9 elective courses, which Christian will talk about in a minute. Several math placements to really try to put students in the place where they are ready to grow and learn, right? Give them the opportunity to enhance where they are now and build from that. Christian is really spearheading, and she'll talk about this later, a really incredible kind of tune-up and enrichment program for those students who can benefit from either end of that learning environment. We'll talk a little bit about Wednesdays. And we are trying to take advantage again with our middle schoolers. An hour and a half block is a long ask. So we're trying to structure those in a way that is developmentally kind of right for them. Different groups operate in slightly different ways. Sometimes they're really into it and they want to power through. But we also want to make sure that those opportunities for social interaction, getting a break, resetting, and then coming back strong are available to them. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
All right, so homeroom and advisory has been a huge success this year. Having the morning and afternoon homerooms, hopefully those of you who have had students here for the past couple of years have seen the, it's provided a lot of support for executive functioning and planning and just the students having that consistent place to go at the beginning of the school day and the end of the school day. Next year's times are going to shift a little bit so that we can provide more passing period time, honestly. So in the mornings, it'll be from 8:20 to 8:35, so it'll be 15 minutes in the morning. And then in the afternoon, it'll remain the same, 3:05 to 3:20. And then the way that we've structured homerooms, we put a lot of thought into this. Sixth grade is grouped, only sixth graders are in sixth grade homerooms. And that's because when sixth graders enter middle school, there's just a lot more new things that they have to learn. And so having them only be with each other, it just provides a lot more safety, a lot more comfort as they like learn all of these new things about Riverstone Middle School. Seventh and eighth grade have mixed groupings. And these mixed groupings are their advisories that they will stick with, those cohorts they will stick with throughout their entire high school experience. And those are going to be their advisory people. Sixth grades, it's kind of interesting. We gave like the sixth grade, every single advisory is named after a river. So we've got like Bruno and Kootenai and Clearwater. And then the sixth grade groupings are named after lakes. Stanley and Cascade. So it's kind of cute because like the lakes feed into the rivers. And so the sixth graders feed into the rivers. And so a couple times a year, they do feed into their bigger advisories and those cohorts that they're going to end up with throughout the rest of their years. And then we have some friendly events and competitions that take place twice per year. We had like a bake-off in the winter, and then we have the big whole school advisory adventure race that's going to take place at the end of the year. And just the benefits of that, they have daily one-on-one check-ins with a trusted adult. They build that sense of community and culture, executive functioning support, and just stability and routine that middle schoolers need.
Do you want to check on meeting room?
I think we're good.
Okay, great.
We also have
question.
Yeah.
Maybe mentioned later, but seem like logical courses after this. What about the afternoon study hall?
That's going to remain the same.
That's going to remain the same. So Monday, Tuesday,
and Thursday is currently the
hall. Yep. Two 6 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
Right, thank
mm-hmm.
you.
Yep.
And then we have more elective offerings next year. So many of them are going to stay the same, especially our really, we've got our successful popular makerspace, computer programming, creative writing, music ensemble, Spanish language and culture are going to remain. And then next year we're going to have gamification with JP, drama and dance with me and Mr. Lindsay. So excited. He's obviously teaching dance. And then
drama and dance.
And then ologies with Bailey Pullman. I'm so excited.
Which is a science elective.
Yeah, all the different, every week they'll focus on a different ology, zoology, marine biology. And then outdoor education with Emily Elsner, which is kind of like a prerequisite for there's a high school outdoor education course that they can take with Derek.
Were these on the original feeler list you put out a few weeks ago?
Yeah. So we did a feeler list in January.
Correct.
And then we made adjustments to it and then offered signups this spring, which all of your children signed up for.
Yeah, these were on the list in the spring. Yeah, these aren't new. The bottom ones aren't new from that.
Nope.
No, but new to next year.
Yes.
Right. Next year. Yeah. No, understand.
And we're continuing to try our best with our small staff in the middle school to offer as many of those elective choices as we can.
Yeah.
Mirroring a little bit what high school is doing, trying to offer as many different options for students to be able to explore some of their interests as we're able. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, please.
Yes.
Oh, thank you. So is there a chance to change the electives during the year? Because it could happen, you decide for something, right? And then after a while, you notice, Probably. Oh, it's good for a while, but probably not the whole year. So is this something maybe we should, I don't know, every semester or I don't know.
Yeah, so we've talked about that. The since the electives are 90 minutes just once a week, that's not a lot of class time to get things done over a long period of time. So the courses are all designed as one-year courses. But if a student has a really strong feeling, and sometimes that happens, especially like in week two, they're like, I really don't think this is for me. There are students who have made change, and what I ask students to do is just come talk to me about it and let's make it work.
Yeah. And this is across all grades, right?
Yes, they're all mixed grade, six, eight.
Yes, six, seven, eight. Yep. Mm-hmm. And so that's on a sort of student case by case basis. And we worked with a couple students this year to help them find their spot. Because electives are designed to have student agency at its heart, right? We want kids to pick and to be excited about their choice. So, did you have a question?
Building on that one, actually, you mentioned that the outdoor education feeds into the high school outdoor education, but does it repeat? So say if someone does it this coming year, is it worth them doing it next year or doing a different one? I'm just trying to see what they've covered in the 2 years.
Yeah, so the electives are currently designed as one-year courses. And so right now we're thinking of them as one experience. And then, so if you are through the whole middle school, you'll get three different elective experiences.
Yeah.
But he's asking specifically about the outdoor education.
Yes.
Does that repeat the exact same course in high school?
It does not.
It does not.
Right.
This is a middle school oriented course, and then there is a high school oriented course later on.
Right. Yeah. And it says outdoor education, but I think you could almost call it outdoor education leadership, right?
Yeah.
It's kind of like building some of those skills that then when we send our students out on multiple outdoor trips a year, right? And those who are really interested in sort of knowing more about how to like run those trips, step up as leaders and be a part of that. I think that's where both Emily and our outdoor education director, Derek Wright, are coming from in offering those courses is some students say, hey, I want to be one of the people who, you know, who really knows my stuff and who takes a lead on those trips. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of it's oriented toward kids who are interested in that. Yeah.
In the spring, the kids were told first come, first serve.
Yep.
Is that still? Okay.
The only thing that we did do is we did ensure that all eighth graders got their first choice.
Yeah.
All rising eighth graders, because they're obviously going to be moving on and they won't have an opportunity again.
And Makerspace is one class that has some safety concerns around it if we get too big, right? If we have, 35 kids running around with bandsaws, it's a problem. So we did limit that course and we did make some choices around for those who had a chance at it this year. We tried to prioritize seventh and eighth graders who had not had a chance at it. So that we're trying to get everyone a chance during their time here, if that, or frankly, drama and dance is something that they're really interested in.
But is there a way to check which one they ended up?
We'll be announcing schedules and their electives, I think over the summer is usually the typical routine. Yeah.
But if somebody has a concern, they can come and talk to you about it.
Definitely.
Sure.
Absolutely.
Open door call to me. I have all the lists.
Yes.
Yeah.
We can talk.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Wednesday programming. Trevor.
So we, along with homeroom, we made a real push this year to really try to emphasize building out our Wednesday programming, and it's been a big success. We're pretty thrilled, and frankly, our faculty are really thrilled with a lot of the experiences that they've been able to provide for students. Wednesdays, our model offers this opportunity to deep dive into a curricular area, but also this year in particular, to get off campus and learn about the world around you in the world around you. And it's something, if many of you have been through my fifth grade class, that's something we really value. If we're learning about the world outside of the classroom, let's get out there and learn about it. And our faculty have really embraced that kind of mindset with the opportunity that Wednesdays provide.
Yeah.
And so that is going to continue next year. We're going to continue working on strengthening our communication about those activities so that you all as parents are aware of what the next opportunities are for the kids and if there are any extra asks or any unique circumstances around them.
Yeah.
We've definitely worked on that this year and are going to continue to try to improve that as we go.
Is there a place where we're going to talk about communication?
Or we don't have a specific communication.
I'm just wondering if we should pause and just for parents who are new to the middle school, talk a little bit about how our communication system for parents and how we communicate with them.
Yeah,
we have a multi-pronged communication system. So when it comes to broader kind of overview, I know, right? This
is, it is multi-pronged.
It is, yes. Yes, we welcome to Riverstone and the pile of stuff we're going to throw at you. No, I'm just kidding. We're trying to streamline it in middle school as best we can. So we've created a routine this year where we send a curriculum overview of kind of what's happened this week and where we are headed next, as well as a kind of highlight reel of what each class has been up to in what we call our coordinator corner posts on Friday. They've been very well read, so we're going to keep that going. We've gotten some feedback that those who are interested in what their kid's up to next in each of their classes has been really appreciated. We also think there's a lot of really cool stuff happening in these classrooms, so we're excited to share those stories. As far as like class-specific material, ManageBack is still our tool for that. So if you're trying to looking at reporting of how your students has done, you know, grades, that kind of a thing, that's where that's coming from. I don't know, what else were you thinking, Damon?
Yeah, I was just going to say that a great way to approach it with your kids actually is they become very familiar with ManageBack because they use it every day in almost every class as their learning management system where they're turning in assignments, receiving marks, those kind of things. Oftentimes, parents don't have quite that level of comfort. And so it's actually really great every week to take the post that is shared, the coordinator corner post, and use that as an opportunity to have your kids pull up their ManageBack. You have a little crib sheet of the kind of stuff you can ask them about, and you can sit there and go through their courses with them. And it's a great way to have a conversation with your kids about their classes on a weekly basis, which is a really good thing to do for middle school students.
No, but last, sorry, please.
No, go ahead. No,
I'll just go for it. I'll just blurt out, so.
I have a comment on this, and I think we talked about this. So I noticed that regarding the grading, so not every teacher is sending emails, and I think it was a message from you that people are getting too many emails about a grading. So, and then I noticed the students get the weekly digest email where all the grading is summarized, but the parents don't get. Mm-hmm. So for me, and also the in the app itself, the chart at the bottom with all the grading disappeared. So with me now, I have to go to each assignment, click on the assignment, and read somewhere a grade. Yeah. So this cost me more time than opening an email, right? So I really would appreciate if something changed on this. It could be the weekly digest email we get as well, right? So then I can talk with the students.
But
something in the system is not right. So sometimes I get an email, but I think it's only one teacher now. We get already a lot of emails, but sometimes I wish we could get the important one.
Right, yes, 100%.
I actually emailed ManageBack to see if parents could get the weekly digest, and they said that they could not. And I don't.
But I think we're going to push back on that. We agree.
Why is the graph? Why disappeared the graph at the end of
that?
That's strange.
Are you viewing that on a phone or a computer?
No phone.
Okay.
The phone has
app had something weird happen with it, like in February. So I'm gonna look into that for you because I do remember that. I remember calling them about it and they said, oh, we'll fix it. So I will double check on that. I didn't realize that was still being an issue.
I need some notification and weekly is fine, right? But
right
now I'm asking Malia, she forwarded me this email.
We'll look into that for you.
Yeah.
So you should be able to see that more easily.
So this would
easier. And we have discussed this with our faculty, and we are in full agreement. So we are working on our management system, ManageBack, to deliver that for us.
Yeah.
So we won't promise that tomorrow, but we are actively working on that.
Yes.
Because we agree.
We agree to do it.
Yeah.
We want you to have the information you need.
To add on to that about the matchback and the grading, which honestly I've been bad about the last month and a half. Last fall, you had an opportunity for us to come in and understand how the grading worked.
Correct.
For those who lived in A, B, C, D, and F.
Sure. And we will be doing that again.
Yes, please.
Every year.
Okay. That was very helpful. And I admit I've slacked off a little bit. But yes, I do agree that having to go into each individual one is just very frustrating.
Yeah.
Now, as far as communication, the one thing you'd said last year when we did this was, if you want to just totally be spaced out of all the minutiae of all the communication, just read the Friday.
That is correct.
Corner. And I agree. I haven't read every single one of them, but I agree. That's the only one that I really pay attention to because it's hard for me to know. Again, I know other people have other kids in other classes, but I really don't want to know what's going on in elementary school, and I really don't want to know what's going on in high school. So it's nothing personal. I just would like to know what's going on.
Well, what I would say is we are doing our best to try to anticipate what can best get information to you. So hearing some feedback is helpful to us. Some we are trying to get fixed because we just totally agree and it's just not working in the system at the moment. But others, if there's a better way, we want to hear that from parents. Email us and say, hey, we really appreciate this, but we're not so sure about this or whatever, because
the Friday's been really good.
We feel that way, but we want to hear from you, because the whole point of this is to make you all feel like you're informed, because when you are informed and we are doing our best, we align as a team on the benefit of our kids, right? And if you're feeling out of the loop, then that is challenging. And if we're not sure what you want to hear, and so we're guessing and throwing a whole bunch of stuff at you, that's not good either, right?
And
so
I think one thing I would add to that is, if you are feeling out of the loop and you can't find what you need, send us an email.
Right.
And we will help you sort it out.
Yep.
Yes.
100%.
If I don't know if you have like a system administrator for ManageBack, maybe it's you.
We do. And we have one. Yeah.
Sometimes I've worked with scheduling software, and like sometimes if you call and ask, like they tell you you can't do this or you can't do that. But if you like working with your registrar, and like if you go into stuff, you'll find you can turn stuff on. Like you can turn on parent access to stuff.
Yes, yeah. We're actively exploring avenues that, and we absolutely agree.
Don't always take what they say as a thing.
Right.
You're right. That would be huge if y'all could just have a weekly digest that gave you grades, like a snapshot.
Yep.
That would be huge.
We agree.
I agree with that for sure.
We'll continue to work on that.
Yeah.
The next one.
All right. So we have some new updates to our technology policy. We're going to utilize our homerooms as the storehouse of all things phone. And so the kids are going to come into morning homeroom, and they're going to drop it off in their spot, and it's going to stay there, and it's going to be happy just sitting by itself all day long. And then the kids can come back at the end of homeroom at the end of the day and pick it up. We think that'll be best for students' mental health and their learning and their attention and their ability to engage with other kids. It removes the temptation like, oh, I'm going to just take my phone to the bathroom or whatever. And the other thing that it does is it makes it really easy to enforce it, because if there's a phone anywhere, it just goes to your homeroom. We don't even have to talk about it. You just take it to your homeroom. So makes things really smooth. All class breaks and lunch are going to be completely screen free. We know that sometimes students want to work on things during lunch or breaks. We actually are not sure that that's a great idea, because they're on screens, they're reading, they're actively engaged all day long. They do need a break from here and there. If a student has a special situation, they're welcome to talk to a teacher, make an arrangement with a teacher to come into a classroom and take care of something. But for the most part, we want them to really take breaks and not just switch to TikTok or something.
And they're receiving chat recipients who are happy about that.
Great. Lovely.
There is so much research that's coming out. There are some really, really strong pieces of information that are saying we need to be really forward thinking on this, and we're the kind of institution that can make that kind of a choice. And so this is something we've been talking about all year, and we really believe in it really strongly.
Yeah.
And we've watched kids in our community and in other communities, the second they step out of the like place where screens are monitored, it's instant. They're immediately into a social media app on their phone. They're not engaging with their peers. And so we think Someone I heard in a different school district brought this up, that over the course of a 365-day year, kids are in school for like 12 to 13% of the time. So that time, it's okay for that time to be a break from that instant feedback hit of what screens and phones and social media in particular give.
So,
yeah, a lot of schools this year are adopting the Yonder program. If you know about that, that's something you guys might want to look at, because one of the things is the liability of having a phone away from the person just because of privacy these days. But the Yonder program is a pretty interesting deal. So okay. That's technology that you might look into.
Yeah.
It's a bag that everybody's given. You put it in, and it seals. It's a magnetic seal. So like at the doors when you leave, so everybody, as you come in, it goes in, you retain. If the phone rings or vibrates, you can ask. Because if it's a parent trying to get hold of you, you can ask you to open the teacher's eligibility too. But they cannot physically open it.
Interesting.
A lot of the events, like venues, mm-hmm. are now going so that you can't like sit there and record right. or do these things.
Yeah.
So it's because you're present. So even for adults, sure. like, it's a problem.
Yeah, right.
So the Yonder one might be an interesting.
Okay,
one.
That's something we'll look into.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, there's always the sneakers.
Right. And honestly, we appreciate that this is an ongoing conversation. Yeah. We are taking next steps, and then we're going to learn from that and then make a next right. step or a different or a side step or whatever. And we're going to continue to have this conversation about how to do this best.
Yeah.
So, yep. So we appreciate ideas like that because that's something really interesting to look into, too.
Can you also include electronic watches in that as well?
I think so.
I think we have not included watches in our policy at this time.
You're
yet.
Not.
Okay. No.
However, you are welcome to include them.
That makes it harder, but yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And
well, I think another thing too is just like we do acknowledge that this doesn't like students can still text from their laptops. They can text from their iPads. So
yes, right. Yeah.
Carlos constantly messaging all day.
Yeah. And so this does not like rid us of any temptations.
Yeah.
And so what we're first and foremost doing is trying to teach technological responsibility and all of those things to the students because they are this is gonna be their world
right.
for the rest of
yeah.
their lives. So first and foremost, we want to teach them how to navigate that responsibly.
Right. And steps like this, but I liked what you said too. Like that does not like just because we're saying we're gonna, you know, keep them out of like these sort of social spaces does not remove our obligation as a school, and then all of our obligation as parents to continue to educate our kids, right? Because their instinct is to jump right into it whenever they get the opportunity.
Yeah.
That is an ongoing question that we're going to have.
It's instant.
Yep,
yeah.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had I won't even go into it, but I was on an airplane last weekend. There was a 14-year-old in front of me, and when the plane landed and you could actually get back on to cell,
Wi-Fi.
She must have connected with 75 different pings in about 12 seconds on Instagram.
Her data,
and she was just boom, 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 and then it was ding, 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 and I could imagine her brain. And this was, we weren't even standing up, getting off the plane yet. You know what I mean? And I think she was doing that all day, every day. Crazy. Yeah.
Also, just around teachers' approach to this mindfulness about technology, we've had a lot of conversations about this. Christian actually brought it up. It's like, hey, we should really think more about this. And that's that, you know, we've been through COVID. And during COVID, a lot of things became digital that weren't digital before. And so one of the things that we're going to be doing over the course of this next year is going through curriculum and looking for opportunities to detect things when that's appropriate, right? Like, is this the best way to deliver this content, or is this just the way we've delivered it for the last couple of years, right? And so we're going to be asking those questions and make sure that there's a compelling reason that a learning experience benefits from being electronic. Great, we'll do it. But we're going to keep having these conversations because some things work great delivered electronically, and some things are just as good or better delivered in other ways. And so we want to be more mindful of that as educators, and we're going to be talking about that with the students so that they think about it also.
One of those things that I have experienced this year that's probably not best delivered electronically and could have some personal like benefit to like a one-to-one person in conversation is math tune-up. Mm-hmm. Are we maybe doing that differently next year where they actually interact with the teacher for tune-up rather than just get sent some IXL things to do?
That is one of the big things we're working on.
Okay. So, and actually, we have a slide about that. So hold that.
This will help, yes. But I don't think it's the best way to approach it.
Right, and it will probably math support will probably always be multi-pronged.
Yes.
But I think that Kristen's going to talk about that, and that's part of the reason that we're giving her more time to spend on this.
Yeah.
Is to make some of those adjustments.
Should we move on to the next? Yep. Were there any online questions or?
They're like in the.
Yeah.
Just have a tiny question. Where do you keep the phones? Is it an open box or?
No.
I was looking for one in this room. They have pockets. It's like a little thing that they have.
Everyone who is entering the room can access the phone.
I think we're going to have some follow-up conversation about that. We have not identified specifically how to keep them secure, but that is a question that we're going to answer before the start of the year.
And they're not going to be visible in the room.
We're not going to leave them unattended by the front door.
No.
No.
That any students who come into the room could grab them. We will have a plan, and we have heard about a bunch of different ideas. This is one I hadn't heard of before, but there are a lot of different ways to secure them so that no one has to worry that something is happening to their device, and that parents don't have to worry that they're sending an expensive device and that it's not being supervised. So, yep, we'll have a plan for that.
And if kids have to leave early, do they?
They can stop by their homeroom and pick it up. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep.
Yep.
And they'll know where to go because it's the same place. Yeah.
Right.
Okay, let's bump ahead. Okay, academic honesty and AI. some of you are really into this stuff, and it's great. So just kind of philosophically, we draw clear boundaries on using artificial intelligence technology, such as ChatGPT, Grammarly, Premium, all the other things that have been developed in the last 6 weeks. And unless they're used in ways that align with academic honesty, their use will be considered plagiarism and dealt with appropriate consequences. And we have seen some of that this year. Students choosing to attempt different kinds of writing using artificial intelligence. As yet, AI, I'm sure, will get better, but right now it's not all that hard to tell that little Johnny didn't write it. But it is something that we're really mindful about, but we're actively teaching, and those of you who have kids here know, that we're actively teaching kids proper and like ways that make sense to use AI, but not for that creative content creation process that we want them to learn, right? There's great ways to use them as a research tool. There's great ways to use them as an outlining tool. There's lots of ways to use them that are really, really great, just not writing your paper, okay? So we'll continue to teach kids about academic integrity, and we do that a lot through their NHD projects. And one of the things that I know that has been a real focus in particularly the humanities classroom is with this proliferation of online tools, making sure that students are engaging with their own authentic thinking and reasoning before being influenced by this world of sources, right? Mm-hmm. And making sure that they are going, they are using their own brains first and thinking and looking at evidence before they're seeing, you know, all this other stuff.
Yeah. I also, just to clarify, there's like a free version of Grammarly, which is similar to just like spell check.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's Grammarly Premium, correct, which is paid for, and it can actually like rewrite your work for you. So I definitely tell my students not to use Grammarly Premium. It's ironic I misspelled Grammarly Premium right now. I use Grammarly Premium to this, but yeah.
Right. Yeah. And we are actively engaging with our teachers. These are complex questions, right?
Yeah.
How to best navigate this moving forward. Learning how to use tools that are becoming available that are advancing us in all these great ways. We want our kids to be exposed to that, but we also want our kids to be creating their own authentic, like higher level thinking skills, right? And just taking an easy out of like, oh, it'll do it for me, isn't helping them develop that. So finding where that middle ground is tricky. And like Damon said, it's changing sort of every day, feels like. So we're actively engaging with our faculty to keep discussing this and finding out and figuring out what the best solutions are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So learning support, which we touched on already. So next year my role is going to lean a lot more heavily into learning support. My focus is in middle school. It'll be kind of expanding into high school and upper elementary as well. But basically, the systems that we have in place right now include student success plans, which are similar to IEPs in the public schools. We do yearly reviews. Within these student success plans, we have individualized toolboxes that are teacher facing more so, so that teachers can know what tools work best for those students. And we even started implementing outdoor education support plans this year, because we had students who needed extra support to be prepared for the outdoor trips that they were going on. And then, yeah, the tune-up program is going to continue to be refined next year. We will offer tune-up in math, in English language arts, and also in executive functioning. Right now, the way that our homeroom is structured actually hits a lot of executive functioning needs for the majority of our students. But for any students who need extra support with planning, organizing, study skills, those sorts of things, we will have a special tune-up for that as well. And the way that the tune-up works is it's offered for a 4-week period. The students meet with their teacher. So their support blocks take place twice a week. So twice a week for 4 weeks, they meet to like tackle one particular skill, one particular area of growth. And the idea is it's just a little tune up, like it's just to kind of get them up to speed. And then after the end of those 4 weeks, then they no longer have to attend support block. I mean, tune-up, sorry, they do have to attend support block, but the tune-up program. There are students who might go to multiple tune-ups in a row. It kind of is case-by-case basis, but the idea is that they operate in 4-week segments. We also have the blast-off program. This logo was made by a student who's now graduated, when we first started doing the blast-off program. But BLAST stands for Better Learning Approaches, Strategies, and Tools. So it's kind of executive functioning support. So it's like a full curriculum. It's a full 4-week curriculum that we used to offer to students after school, if they were like new students or if they were students who needed extra organizational support. We are now, next year, we're going to be doing the blast off program with all of our incoming 6th grade students. So it's going to be study skills, organizational skills, diving into ManageBac, understanding how ManageBac works, understanding planners, all of those things take place during that 4-week session. And then there are support blocks in each grade level. And then of course, like all of our curriculum is, it's inquiry learning. There's something called universal design for learning. And it's basically just giving students more choice in their learning, which is how our inquiry units are structured. And this lends itself to differentiated instruction for students. So you'll notice that when students are creating projects, they have a lot of choice in their projects. And that lends itself to our students being able to capitalize on their strengths. And their different learning styles and
pursue their interests.
Yeah.
Right.
I think one more thing that I just wanted to point out is in addition to supporting students who might have a challenge in a particular area, TuneUp is also, that program's also begin to be used to offer students advancement and acceleration opportunities as well. Yeah. That's something we piloted this year that's going to be a part of the program next year fully.
We've had students in the past who felt like they wanted to level up in math, so then they have used the TuneUp program to have focus support so that they could move up a math level. And then if you want more information, sorry, I don't know if this is me, but if you want more information on the middle school curriculum, our Riverstone website now features our curriculum that's new this year, and you can see all the cool things that we're doing on the website.
Yep, and we'll probably send this slide deck out in our Friday post tomorrow as well. So if anyone wants to jump on through this link and look, we've put some real work this year into writing kind of overview styled course descriptions of all of our courses. But this spring, we throughout the entire middle and high school also started kind of a new initiative on a course by course kind of level to develop a sort of uniform syllabus. Each teacher has been tasked with creating syllabi for each of their courses, and that's grades 6 through 12 in every subject area. So it's been a big lift this spring. Most teachers, of course, had a very like detailed plan, but we didn't have sort of a unified sort of
consistent way to share that out. And we kind of considered it with three audiences. One was parents, one is students, and one is new and incoming faculty, right? And we wanted to create a document for each course where someone could take a look and have a really clear understanding of how kind of scope and sequence, how a course progresses through a semester and through a year. And so those are being refined. We have drafts of them at this point. Our goal, I think, is at the start of next school year for those. I think you'll see that teachers in your students' classes will be sending those out to those multiple audiences.
Yeah, and I could show you an example because this one is finalized, but it'll look something like this. It'll have an overview. Oh, I lost my mouse. There we are. It'll have like an overview, the class text, class materials, and then it'll dive into each unit of inquiry and
like
exactly
the progression of sort of skills and activities.
And this will be for, sorry, was someone else?
Oh, no, go ahead.
Was this going to be for the whole year or is this going to be per the?
Yeah, it'll, it breaks
in chunks.
It breaks it down. It breaks it down into units, but that progress through the whole year.
Yeah. And the great thing about this is no longer do you have to go on ManageBack to find your kids' units and the sequence. You can just look at this document and it takes you right through every class.
Yeah.
Right? So. It is not a daily calendar, right? So it's not saying like on, because it's not, frankly, that's not how inquiry works, right? And it's not the kind of institution we are, right? We're able to be flexible and nimble and adjust to the needs of our students. So we're not the kind of place that's going to say on Wednesday, October 7th, we're on page 12, right? Mm-hmm. But it'll show you the way that we're progressing and the thoughtful kind of progression that each teacher has put into the way that their year develops.
And what our formative assessments are going to be.
And yeah, where and when assessments will be. And it'll give you an opportunity then if you see something and you have some questions, you can reach out to the three of us or you can reach out directly to your teacher and say, hey, I see this is coming on the horizon and I wanted to kind of check in or whatever. Yeah, did you have a question?
Yeah, I have a comment. It's a little related to this, but I think this is a good place to address it.
Yeah.
I heard from the students, and I think it's great to have math and language every day. I think I really like this setup, right? And you keep probably going with this, right?
Yes, we definitely are.
So the point is sometimes, or not sometimes, but quite often, they are getting the homework next day assigned, which is a problem in language and in math. Compared to the others where you have an A day and B day, right? You have a day in between.
Yeah.
So this could sometimes a little challenging if you have other activities in afternoon to struggle around a little with other homeworks as well. So maybe
That's interesting feedback. We'll make a note of that. That's something that we could investigate.
The other day,
sure.
Whatever.
Yeah.
It's actually something that came up. The math department just had a department meeting. That's actually an issue that came up in the department meeting that we were talking about.
And then another feedback is like the time when a test is graded. So I see from time to time, 2 to 3 weeks.
Yes.
So the child is already preparing for the next test, or sometimes I forget that this was a test, right? I remember for a couple of days, but then I don't ask anymore. So could we, I don't know. I know the teachers are busy, but sometimes like for easily gradable thing, right? A week or so?
We
there's some exceptions, but
right. No, and we appreciate that feedback and that's something that we can bring back to our faculty too.
And I agree.
Right.
Sometimes it is 2-3 weeks down the road and you're like, oh well wait a second, we did that. We've already done two things since then.
Sure.
Right. Yep.
I think our typical the word protocol or expectation is that the students should receive a grade before their next assessment.
Right? That's covering the same sort of skill. Right.
Yeah. So like they shouldn't have multiple assessments that are outstanding grades.
Mm-hmm. But I'll say that this is a perfect example of like we like to get this kind of feedback because it gives us some conversations to have.
For sure.
Writing out the tests throughout the semester.
Yep.
Yes,
yeah,
and so
last semester where we piled up everything before Christmas,
right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Everything, because you're saying we need 8 grades in per semester per subject, right? And everything.
I think there's two things at work there. Number one is we do have finals at the end of every semester, and that is a thing. And you know, that is something that we do because we want kids to have that sort of complete concluding experience. Mm-hmm. And also, you're right, we want teachers to have multiple grades, but one of the things that we're going to be able to do now that we have more of Trevor's time is going to be able to do those regular unit meetings with teachers.
Yep.
To ensure that we're coordinating that stuff better. Because I just want to point out all the great work that Trevor and Christian have done. And technically, like, between the two of them doing this MYP coordination thing, it's they're not even allocated a single full time between the two of them. So I want to point this out. And so
next year we'll both be full time.
Correct. Right. And so that's going to open up a lot more resources for ensuring that details like that get corrected and things. Right. So yes.
Yeah. Good. But again, to reiterate, you all are experiencing this. And again, we are a team, right? It is the three of us and our faculty and you all as parents trying to make the best experience we can for the kids. So we love to hear feedback of like, hey, this would benefit my ability to help my student. We put that away and we think, okay, how can we adjust some of our protocols? How can we adjust some of our expectations? So
and that's
please consider it an open door to especially reach out to the three of us and say, hey, I've got a thought here.
Yeah.
Can you work on this? Right. And we'll go see what best we can do.
Yeah.
So.
And I love having homeroom for that reason too. Like just the other day I asked my homeroom, I was like, okay, is anybody feeling overwhelmed? And they were like, yes. And I was like, what are you? Okay. All right. I'm ready to hear it. What are you feeling overwhelmed with? And they were like, English. And I was like, oh.
I'm the English teacher.
No kid.
And it is one of the functions of homeroom. Yeah, is to check for things like that, like that kind of a situation at the end of the semester. Like we really want to create those opportunities for you and for students.
Yeah.
Right. One more thing I want to talk about is civil dialogue. So we all know we're heading into an election year, which is bound to be exciting. So one of the things we really want to emphasize with students as we travel through this time together is how we speak with each other about the issues that will come up in class in a respectful way and make sure that we're all agreeing together to think well about these things. And we're going to be doing additional training with teachers on this. We're going to be doing take some additional time with students to work on these communication and reasoning skills to make sure that they're prepared so that all of our classes can benefit from these techniques. And so, this is a both and thing. Teachers need to be doing things and students need to be doing things. And so teachers are going to model a posture of listening, right? Like we want to hear from you.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to do that.
You're
I'm
fine.
Sorry. You can continue.
Okay. I just am not going to remember what bullet point two is.
Okay.
It's okay. But so we're in the process. We're going to release it soon. A web page on our school website about civil dialogue and kind of about Riverstone's beliefs about the importance and value of that. And what we want to do is ensure that students feel safe in their classes as they're talking about things. We want to create those safe spaces. We also want to make sure that students get to speak about the things that are important to them as they come up appropriately in the lesson, right? We're not having an open forum on every topic you want to talk about, but if it's appropriate and if it applies to the material we're talking about, we want students to be able to share what they think and share their opinions. But we also want them to learn to share what is the source that you got this information from, or tell us about why you believe this, or what kinds of experiences have led you to this conclusion, right? So we want to make sure that we're evaluating all different kinds of information. And so that's going to be something that we're going to be talking about like personal experience. How about research? How about evidence that's out there in the world, right? And making sure that we're engaging with all those different things.
But how do you manage whether the evidence is true or not?
Well, we have to talk about that, right? We have to talk about truth and how we establish a claim academically, right? Like what establishes a legitimate claim academically? And so we're going to be talking about that.
Sorry, I'd like to add one other thing is this. I mean, everybody has a right to opinion. That's what I love about this country.
You have absolutely right.
You have a right to choose.
You do.
But how is it going to be emphasized is to take the middle ground and not get so bipolar? That's polarized.
I think you look at this last bullet point, right? And I think this
is really important. So as an institution, we're not trying to frame students' opinions or perspectives, but we're trying to broaden their perspective to have a better understanding of each other and each other's views, right? So that's where we come down. Of course, parents have a role in this as well, right? In creating kind of the worldview that your child processes through, right? So I think that comes back to me too, again, that teamwork, that kind of triangle of team of the school, of parents, and then doing that on benefit of the students.
Right.
So,
And I think these two bullet points I think are really key. I think the recognizing and embracing that discomfort's a pathway to learning for ourselves and our students. If somebody shares something that makes us feel uncomfortable, let's learn to ask questions about that and find out more, right? And like Trevor pointed out, we're not expecting students to adopt others' points of view. That's up to them, right? What we're interested in is that they're exposed to as many perspectives as possible and that they're encouraged to respond to those intelligently and have the thinking skills and the communication skills to address those issues in the way that they're going to choose, right? That's the goal.
So just like with AI, a very complex issue that is changing daily. So we're on our toes and we're trying our best to create that kind of supportive environment for the kids.
Yep. Agreed.
All right. I think.
Oh, yeah. That's it. All right. Questions that we haven't yet covered.
Any questions from our online crew too? We want to make sure you're heard if we haven't addressed something that is important to you.
Something piddly, but just curious. You know, I drive out here a lot. And every time I drive out here, I drive past North. And every day at North, kids are out there, gym shorts, gym shirt, and they're out running laps or doing something. Seems to me, and maybe I'm not getting the straight story from my little grommets, but PE here isn't necessarily physical education. It's not getting out and getting the whales out. You know, I know at the beginning of the year, it was a lot more heightened. There was, I think they were trying to figure it out beginning of the year. And there was a lot of people like, I'm just not going to do it. And some of the kids are like, or my kids are like, why are they not doing it? And why aren't we out running laps around the soccer field and, you know, doing PE? And so is there a plan for next year to kind of get the kids to maybe do a little bit more physical stuff? I mean, it's an important part of not as you're growing, not just grow your brain, but to grow your body because it's the temple, right? And I mean, I'm not here all day, so maybe I don't see it and I'm not getting the straight story, but is that something that could be addressed?
So there's a two-part kind of answer to that. So one is there's a lot of physical activity happening during, there are significant opportunities for breaks during the day, and those who pursue it are quite physical. So we have a group of, you know, my son and a bunch of the eighth grade boys are playing basketball and football every second they have, and there are plenty of opportunities during the day for them to do so.
And the sixth graders in particular, a lot of our classes, the teachers try to have, because all of our longer block courses, we have a 10-minute break in the middle, and a lot of the teachers, we try to make that 10-minute break at the same time.
They're so basically, the sixth graders are basically always on the playgrounds
the sixth graders
or
like to play tag,
on the basketball.
And they are running.
All over campus.
Yeah.
Right. So that's one part.
And then,
and then PE itself.
To speak to PE.
Right.
We are... We're balancing all the different parts of the kids' education here, right? And PE is a part of that, and it's a part of the requirements of the MYP, and it's really important, as you said, for kids. And PE, as part of the MYP, also requires some assessments and some research and things like that that our kids are required to do too.
And reflection.
But we set as the standard for our PE course is it should be at least 70% physical activity throughout the year so that we have that kind of expected threshold for that. And I know that Ms. Elam has been working really hard this year to make sure that that's happening. The other thing that I will say is
we have three different PE teachers using one gym and one field. And so that's actually something this year we've been able to deconflict a little bit. The high school's need for PE space has declined just because of their schedule and their stuff that they're doing. And so we're going to be able to have more time when we can access all those facilities during our PE classes and not have to share them. So I think there's going to be some great opportunities for doing that.
Yeah. And then with outdoor education too, I mean, obviously that's not consistent throughout the year, but that amps up as they get older. So like when they get into seventh grade, they start doing the longer bike trip. When they get into eighth grade, they're doing the big backpack. So that amps up a lot.
Yeah.
All right. Is there any plans, or I don't know how often you're using these tennis courts besides tire throwing or So we don't have a tennis team, but I'm not sure this space is completely used, or maybe there's some other better.
Yeah, no, we totally agree with you. The tennis courts are actually been a topic of facilities discussion at length, and they've actually got multiple different alternatives they're looking at for how to best use that space. One of them is to put in pickleball courts.
I was going to say pickleballs.
One of them is to restore tennis. And then there's a few others. And so our facilities team is looking at their funding and what they have to work with. But that's absolutely a topic of discussion, is how to best use that space and for physical education. Right. Yes.
But TBD for now.
Yeah.
I was going to say, first we have to remember with PE, there's a curriculum and our kids have PE twice a week for 45 minutes. So that's not their exercise for the day.
No, that's not.
You have to do something outside of that if we want them to, get their exercise for the day.
Correct.
But two, I was thinking something maybe we could do is bins of outdoor stuff to maybe we have stuff in our garages that we could donate, a bin or a big garbage can of wheels of stuff that they could do outdoors at lunch something to do, frisbees, jump ropes, I don't know, old skateboards, maybe that's probably not.
Yep.
No, that's huge. We had an eighth grader who that was his design project this year. But what we learned is that it really needs to be structured. There needs to be a sign in, sign out process.
No, he just has to collect it at the end of the day before we go home now.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, I've heard there's a solution. So,
Yeah.
And so that's actually something that we're developing. We actually have some seventh graders who are going to be eighth graders who are also interested in that topic. And so the kids are actually building our solution for that, which is actually kind of cool.
Yeah.
And that's actually
it
how
cool.
It's supposed to work. We want kids to identify a problem and then find a way to address it,
with our support.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Just to tag on to the PE, if there's a way to build a PE schedule to kind of off balance what's going on in the classroom, so that at the beginning of the school year and the end of the school year when the stress levels are high, maybe that's when they get to move freely or do more in PE.
That's a great idea.
Evaluation and reflection and the health component can be more in the middle when it's not so heavy, so that when school starts and they're kind of overwhelmed, they can go out and
That is a wonderful idea.
That's the beauty of PE, right?
Yeah.
Balance. And
absolutely.
I appreciate the health component and it's important, but maybe time it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When their stress level is a little more.
I think that's wonderful idea. Yeah.
Again, these are the opportunities that we have as a small and nimble school to hear ideas like that and say, let's try to put that into practice. So,
absolutely.
So, not to pile on, but. Team sports. What's happening with team sports?
Oh yeah, we can talk about that.
Yeah, there's a lot of developments.
Yeah, there are. So we continue to offer the team sports that we've offered, which is track, cross country, volleyball, basketball. But and then we have co-ops for other sports with schools. And if you have a child centered in a particular sport, let us know. We'll help you find what you need to. The other thing though that we are doing is we have created a partnership with Sage, who does not have their own athletic facilities. And so it kind of piloted this year with a player who played on our basketball team. And so we have a limited partnership with them to for their students who are interested in playing sports to have the opportunity under parameters to play on our teams with our students. It gives our students a broader social connection. It allows students to play sports who would like to. Other schools do this for us, right? Like we send our students to other schools for sports that we don't offer. So we're doing that for them. And it creates more stability in our numbers, right? Because we've got small cohorts and sometimes they are concentrated more toward the boys or the girls side. And most of our sports are not co-ed. So this gives us the opportunity to balance those things out too, right? So
what are the team sports?
Huh?
What are the team sports?
We have volleyball, basketball.
Girls volleyball and then co-ed cross country in the fall, boys and girls basketball in the winter, and then track and field in the spring are our primary sports offerings. We have opportunities for ultimate frisbee. We have a team that middle schoolers and high schoolers can participate on and they compete. We have an outdoor, oh my gosh, what do you call it? Orienteering.
Yes.
For those students who are interested in like running around like crazy people out in the wilderness. That's an opportunity.
Yep.
No judgment there. Run across country. Just run across country.
I think Ms. Liebeck would be sending out the volleyball here soon because she sent it out in spring.
Yep.
Yeah.
You'll hear that. You'll hear
so those are the those yeah. are our offerings as official Riverstone team sports.
Cool. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah.
There's a there's discussion of rugby as well, but we haven't got there yet.
Mm-hmm. And mountain biking.
Mountain biking right. will certainly exist as a club,
right?
And may exist as a sports form as well.
Right. Oh, we have skiing.
Oh, we have a ski team. Yes, right. I always forget about the ski team.
Well, it doesn't.
Always like you didn't
on campus, so
right?
It feels us. Yeah.
Yep. We always get annoyed when we don't.
Yeah. Yeah.
Cool. Great. Any other questions or suggestions, feedback?
And if we haven't made it clear enough, questions don't have to end tonight. So if you go home in a little bit and you're like, should ask that. Just email us. We want to be a leadership team. We want to have an open door policy. Right. And the more feedback and questions we get from you, the better it helps us shape the direction we're going collaboratively together.
So, yep.
Maybe not the place, but how's recruitment going for the middle school? Because, I mean, you know, this year we're going to be dropping down sixth going seventh. We're dropping down to an anemic volume of boys, you know. And so is there a point in time where you will start sharing next year's numbers and things like that?
We don't typically, because they always change, typically. What I can tell you is that we have new students already completely signed and delivered at every grade level in middle school. And our middle school is going to be larger next year than it was this year.
Cool.
Yep.
So. And probably bigger than I am even thinking. I'm just, in my mind, I know what the numbers are that have already completely signed.
Can you mention the ratio per classroom?
I don't have all that off the...
Yeah. I don't have that in my brain.
Right.
Yeah.
Fourth and sixth, two ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Well, thank you guys for coming. Thank you, everyone online, for joining us. We really value these opportunities for us to come together collectively. So thank you for giving us this time. We really appreciate it. And we're really excited about next year.
We are.
We're glad to have you all on board with us. And it's going to be a really good year.
Yep.
And we're going to finish strong the last, what is it? Eight school days or something? Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. So finish strong and then on to the next year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I also feel like it's been a really great year this year.
For sure.
Is there a plan for next year to finish school before Memorial Day? Like local.
I have to go and look at the. I will get back to you on that. I have to go look at the master calendar. It's out. It's been released, so I just don't have it in my head.
I think it's similar to this year.
Yeah.
Yeah. Students are so stressed out, you cannot do something over Memorial Day because you have two extra days of school, Tuesday and Wednesday.
Party days.
We have a whole crew who's in charge of the looking at the master schedule, and they always appreciate feedback. So
we can
find you the right people to reach out to, but that's not the three of us.
Who's in charge of setting up Zoom meetings and the technique? Because I think Zoom meetings could be better, or meetings in general, right? Because sometimes you don't have time to come here.
Yeah.
Zoom meetings, like, and also when I'm sitting home, that I someone hears me.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
So the quality of the Zoom meeting, okay. And I think you have the technique, right, from COVID.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Everything was possible during COVID, but now okay. I feel sometimes the Zoom meetings, so the quality is not really good. The presentation, sometimes you don't see it on the screen. If you say something, no one hears you.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Yeah, well,
it's a general.
Always troubleshooting.
Yeah, and that's something we'll look at, because we do want the presentation, the online experience, to give you the information.
Are you talking about like these meetings?
Gotcha.
That's part of the reason why we moved to this room, is because this used to be my room,
and
I'm the most familiar with this technology in this room.
Yeah. So I had Zoom meetings where actually I didn't see the presentation on the screen. It was just the camera, and the laptop was everything.
Sure.
Yeah.
We'll pass that along.
For sure.
Yeah.
Cool.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you for coming.
Again, email if something else comes up.
Yeah, thank you, guys.
Oh yeah, we are going to